Our subject is the Marienkirche in Berlin. My advice, if you want to draw this as well, is that you watch the video, listen to my explanation of my thought processes, but that you then put the video to one side, print off a copy of the reference photo, and it will be on my YouTube community page for you to do that, and do your drawing. And then come back and compare it with mine and see where they're the same, see where they're different. If you want, listen to the video again and listen to my process and see how it matches up with your experience. I truly believe this is the most helpful way for you to grow in your own ability to draw. Otherwise, you just learn to copy line by line another artist's work, and that's not going to help you create your own original drawings, which is, I'm sure, what you want to do. So get ready. I hope it's as much fun for you to draw as it was for me. And apologies, but I forgot to have the camera on for the very last section, so it appears suddenly. It's always helpful to have a good look at our reference before we start and to work out what we want to make the first thing we draw. And I choose something where I think will be easier to get the proportions correct, because whatever part of the drawing I'll draw first, I'll use as a measuring stick for other parts of it. And so I choose this sandy part of the tower, and I work hard at getting the proportions correct. It's important to choose the order in which we do things, particularly when we place windows. I like to make sure I place the apex of the window if it comes to a point, but also to make sure I position the sides, so if there's meant to be an equal space on each side, there is. Look, I probably draw this part of the tower a little bit squat, and so I bear that in mind as I then draw the rest of the tower. So I create the three-dimensionality by just doing this very oblique sidewall that we can just see a bit of, but it adds a lot of interest, so we want to make sure we put it in and not be tempted just to make the tower square on. So now I look to see where the apex of the tower comes, because it doesn't actually come over that center window because of the angle that we're looking at the tower from. So I want to make sure that I position this tower. With towers and spires such as this, the really important thing is to have it looking really nice and straight, and so that there's a center line that goes right through the center of everything. And it's not as simple as just drawing a straight line. We have to look to see where the center at the very top is on our reference photo and position it. So you probably can't see it, but there is a spot on my page which isn't where the tower is going to end, where the spire is going to end, but it is the center line for the whole structure. And so stacking these shapes really exactly and really tightly on that center line is most important part of a spire. So as I do, if you like, each section of the spire going up, I pay particular attention that I get the stacking on the center line correct. It's more important than any of the detail. It's the single most important thing to take into consideration drawing a spire. And when I come to draw the very top of the spire, if you like, the pointy cone on the top, I make sure I put the dot in the spot where I want it to end, and then I draw the lines down to the sides of the part underneath. And you'll see me do this now. There it is. And that way, the top of the spire is in the right spot. I found that's much more accurate than drawing the lines from the tower up to the point. Now I need to work out how far this line goes, and this is where I use what I've already drawn as a reference. So I do establish where the base will be at the bottom, and I also start to put in the tops of the trees. It becomes a little more complex with foreground when you've got overlapping objects. The important thing is to draw the closest thing before we draw the things that pass behind it. And that way we get our lines in the best spots and we don't draw things over the top of other things, which in ink is always pretty obvious. So I'm basically starting from the church, then the trees, the fence, the people, the lampposts, whatever is going to be closest in that particular section, I do first so that I can then draw the things behind. And now I use my spire to measure the length of the roof of the nave of the church. And you saw me do it there. And so now I take a bit of time to try and get these lines as straight as I can. My hand is hitting one of my lights just off camera on the right. So I'm now finishing the trees, but I'm also positioning the detail along this side wall. And the principle I follow is that I do first the things that are going to be most visually prominent. So the windows that are at the far end of the church, where not much is drawn at the moment, those windows there are much more exposed to view than behind the trees. And so when I do the windows, I'll actually start with them at that right-hand side, and I'll make sure I position those nice and evenly, because if the ones on the left-hand side don't fill the gaps as well, it won't be as obvious. But before I do that, I'll start to put in some of the foreground, some of the figures. I've got these lamps to do. And again, I'm following my principle of, in any given spot, I'll always draw the thing that's closest to the viewer so that the things that pass behind it, I know where to leave their lines. And there's a few details to have to juggle at the same time. There's this triangular topped side door that's a bit fancy that sits in front of some of these windows. But the important thing is to position the windows evenly, because if I don't get this detail right, it will be obvious. And so it's one of those details that's important to get right, more important than some of the smaller detail, where it's just really creating the effect of the detail. These windows will stand out, and if they're not even, it will look odd, because we'll have a sense of they're meant to be evenly spaced. And then if I get the windows in the right place, the buttresses that stand between them are very easy to put in, because there's room to put them all in between the windows. And I don't have to worry about the windows really behind the trees. And now I put these buttresses in, and I'm just suggesting the interior of the windows. I'm not trying to draw the lead light that holds the panes in place, even though it's quite visible, at least for that end window. So now I work on some of the foreground, and this is the sort of detail where you need to work out what you're going to put in and not put in. I decide I'll put almost all of it in, except for these seats, this circular ring of seats on the outside of this paved circular area. I decide that will firstly be tricky to get done, and I think it's just too many lines in too small a space and will end up looking awkward and detracting from the church overall. It can be very helpful to leave things out so that whatever the main subject is stays the main subject. But putting some people in is very important for a sense of scale, and it's very important that we get them right, that they're all basically on level ground, so we need to line up the heads, and we need to make sure that the ones that are furthest away really are small, and the ones closer are large or larger. A little trick I have is to draw the head a little bit smaller than you think it might need to be, because it's easy enough to sort of add an extra line to the top if we need to make it larger. But a head that's too large for the scale we want, there's really nothing we can do about it. So I add these last few figures, and then it's starting to look pretty much done. Now, sadly, I forgot to turn the camera on for the last part of the drawing. So here it looks at the end of my session. And I spent about 40 minutes drawing this in real time. But the only things that I have done is the apse at the rear of the church on the right-hand side. And notice that I've drawn it in a very loose style, because I find that by drawing things on the edges loosely concentrates our attention on the central portion of the drawing, which is usually where the focus is. And then I had the buildings on the left-hand side behind the church, and I've drawn them with a very light touch because that helps them to look further away. And that mimics what happens in life, where we don't focus so clearly or even see so clearly things that are further in the distance. So how do you think my Marienkirche looks? I hope you have a go drawing it yourself. The reference photo is on my community page, so go and print it off. G'day, I'm Stephen Travers. I hope you have a go drawing this building. But again, can I remind you, I think the most helpful way for you to use this video and this resource is to watch the video, listen to how I explain my process in my head, and then to put the video to one side, print off the reference photo, and draw it yourself. And then if you want, you can compare it with with my drawing. You can listen to the video again and think through your process compared to my process. But if you just draw along line by line to my video and my drawing, you'll just be concentrating on copying the lines I draw, and you won't be getting practice at developing your own ability to think creatively and to translate a photograph into a drawing. And that's the skill that we all want. So we need to do the thing, we need to practice the thing that will develop that skill. This isn't the normal sort of video I do. So if you found it helpful, and if you would like me to do more, please put it in the comments. Is this an appropriate level of drawing? Is it too difficult? Is it too simple? Let me know, because they are a lot of fun for me to make, but there's no point if no one's going to do the drawings. So please let me know. And of course, as you do it, have fun. I'll see you next time. Bye.